Okay, let's talk some karma. This is an interesting class that generates all kinds of endless discussion as everyone tries to figure out ways that the universe hasn't figured out to not be accountable for things that they actually do in life. So feel free to fire them at me when they come to mind. We'll see if we can find any loopholes, but probably not. Great quote. I love this one. Do what you wish. That's the only law, but know that you must account for all your actions. Now, we have this whole free will thing, right? Having the intellectual center allows us free will. Free will means we get to do whatever we want, which means we get to not necessarily do the will of our higher self, okay? Which was kind of, in Christianity, represented by the will of the Father, you know, our Father who art in heaven, and all that kind of stuff. That will be done. That's referencing the will of our higher self, the will of our Father in heaven, so to speak, the will of the spiritual side of ourselves. Now, because we have free will, we get the ability to not do that if we choose. So that's our rule for life. We get to do whatever we want. That's the gift that we've been given, the gift of free will. But the catch is, know that at some point we have to account for all our actions. So we're free to choose our path, but at some point, every time we push to one extreme, the universe is going to correct the balance by pushing to the other extreme, right? Because if we know anything, the universe is going to correct a balance, okay? And the universe is really like a mirror. It just reflects back what you project onto it. And that's really what karma is all about. If everything that you do is negative and ill-willed and selfish, then that is the stuff that reflects back to you. And what we're going to see today, karma is intimately related to the law of return and recurrence and the law of evolution and involution as well. Remember last week we talked about return and recurrence, and we simply said when we die, we come back and we take on a new body. Why is it we do that? Because we have the ego. The ego is keeping us trapped and bound to this physical plane. Until we eliminate the ego, we're always going to keep coming back to a physical body. The ego prevents us from ascending to the higher dimensions and reuniting back with the source. Remembering that when we do return, when we do come back to take a new body, we're governed by the law of recurrence, which basically means every single life is basically the same thing as the last one before it. We're put in the same situation over and over again so we can make the right choices. But we keep making the wrong ones over and over. Anytime you identify with an ego, that's the wrong choice. Anytime you identify and listen to your consciousness, your higher self, that's the right choice. We keep being put in situations where time and time again, we identify with the ego and we do its will instead of our own. And that brings consequences that we're going to look at today with karma and dharma. As we've discovered in previous lectures, our mechanical dimension is governed by numerous laws. Okay, there's all kinds of different laws that govern our existence here. We're familiar with laws like, you know, the law of gravity as an example of one. But there's all kinds of other laws as well. And many times some of the challenges, the obstacles, the stresses we encounter in life are because we don't properly understand all the different laws that are acting on us. And consequently, we find ourselves, you know, going against the flow, trying to swim upstream all the time. Okay, so our dimension is governed by a lot of different laws. We looked at the law of return and recurrence last week. We looked at the law of evolution and involution last week. And the law of karma is another one like that. Another interesting thing to note, to make reference to, is as you go up higher into the various dimensions or parallel universes or different planes, if you want to think of it that way, you get less laws. Okay, so the higher you go up dimensionally, the less laws there are governing your existence. That's why when the ancient people had experiences in the higher dimensions, that's why they called them paradisiacal regions or heavens, because there's a lot less laws, therefore more freedom. You know, compare living in Canada to, say, living in a communist country. It's better in Canada. We have more freedoms because there's less laws governing our behavior. The same thing happens when you go up dimensionally. Now, when you go down dimensionally, you get more laws, which is why when the ancient people had experiences in the lower dimensions, they said, oh, it's horrible, it's a place of suffering, and that's where we got the concept of the various hells and infernals and that kind of stuff. The law of karma and dharma is another law that governs our universe. It's something else that we're subject to, and it's a law that actually goes quite high. It has its origins quite higher dimensionally, and a lot of different beings are governed by karma. Even some of the entities that dwell in the higher dimensions, angels for lack of a better term, they're governed by karma as well, because karma is a law that operates from quite a high level. Another way to think of karma is you can think of it as law of cause and effect, or you could also call it the law of action and consequence. Okay, so karma is just more of an Eastern philosophy that was given to that, but you could call it cause and effect, you could call it action and consequence. It really means the same thing. If you kind of remember these little terms, it kind of helps you understand how the law itself works. We have to understand this law to negotiate the ship of our life properly. Really not understanding this law causes a lot of problems in life. Understanding this law and knowing how to use it to our advantage can make a huge impact in the quality of your life. Because there's a lot of things you can do once you understand how karma works to help make situations a lot more favorable to you. Okay, because remember, as I tried to explain earlier, these laws, sometimes we don't understand them, so we find ourselves fighting, we're going against the flow all the time. If we really understand the law and know how to use it, then we can take advantage of those currents and use them to our benefit. Yes?
So, when people are put in situations that they are not really in control of, mm-hmm. and they have to, let's say, they're a soldier and they have to kill, mm-hmm. or they're et cetera, et cetera. Mm-hmm. How does that factor into the law of karma? Into the law of karma?
Hold that thought, because we'll look at this. We'll look at some scenarios. Okay. We'll give you some kind of an insight.
Because I've read in like parts of the Bhagavad Gita and, mm-hmm. and Shiva, and talks to the soldier, and like, I don't know, it's just like fighting without desire, but that's still doesn't really make sense, because you always just have an ultimate choice.
Yeah.
It seems like I don't know, yeah?
In the end, it's action and consequence.
All right.
We look at things, we try to, as we'll see today, we try to impose our own moral codes and our own reasoning and our own rationalization,
but there's still the
action and consequence. Yeah, and we'll explore a lot of that. Karma is a law of compensation, not punishment or vengeance. It's kind of, we like to look at it as punished, being punished, kind of this concept of, oh God, why have you smitten me? That's this kind of idea. But really, it's compensation. It's us receiving what we are owed from a universal standpoint. So it's not that we're being victimized, it's not that we're being punished, it's not that the universe is evil or cruel, because those are qualities that we as humans ascribe to things. The universe itself as a whole is beyond the concept of good and evil. Okay, a famous Eastern quote, an Oriental quote, is there is no good and evil, there's simply what is and what will come. Our interpretation of that is good and evil based on the time period, based on our background, our culture, customs, social rules and etiquette and that kind of thing. But in the end, good and evil, that's a human concept. There's simply what is and simply what will come. Okay, so to think of karma being compensation, we're just receiving what we're owed. We simply reap what we sow. This concept of God up there smiting everybody under his thumb, that's our twisted interpretation of things, right? Karma tends to, when you're on the receiving end of it, appear to be cruel and, oh, why have you forsaken me? And, oh, woe is me. We tend to do that. But once you really understand this law and once you really start to work with some of this stuff, you see that it's simply just your own actions coming back to you. So once we learn how to modify our actions, then we can learn to work with karma, and that's what we're going to look at today as well.
And I think also if we can see it as a learning experience, to
yes.
take from that and learn and grow
Everything that happens to you is an opportunity for you to perfect yourself, eliminate ego, and bring yourself closer to the source. Everything, the good, but also the negative as well. That's a really good point. Remembering the concept of justice, or the concept of justice, she stands and she holds the scale, right?
Mm-hmm.
And justice represents balance. The concept of balance is beyond good and evil, okay? Balance is balance. You push something to the left, it's going to swing to the right. That's like looking at a pendulum and saying, when the pendulum goes left, it's good. When the pendulum goes right, it's bad. What's the difference? The pendulum is swinging between two opposite polarities. Okay, so the concept of justice is beyond good and evil. It's all compensation. Literally, you reap what you sow. Let's leave it this way. Karma, you leave it like a medicine that's applied to us for our own good. We're supposed to be learning a lesson, as we just mentioned, and perfecting ourselves. That's what our job is. You know, what's the meaning of life? To perfect ourselves. Basically, to deify ourselves, to ascend back to the source, bringing all this experience, bringing all this information, and reuniting back with the One, the source of all things, God, for lack of a better term. That's the meaning of life. That's what we're supposed to be doing. We got distracted and fallen off that path a long time ago. Yep.
So we're on the bottom, right?
Yes.
So now if you get to the next level,
mm-hmm.
if you don't do something right, do you just keep circling? Or how does that work? Do you forget
no,
things
you,
there,
you can,
or are you just on to up, 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 up?
On to up, up, up. providing you don't fall, and we'll look at that concept later on, because it's hence the term fallen angel, right? You've heard of that term. A fallen angel is a being that was living on a much higher realm of existence, but ended up back down here again and has to make that climb. That's a talk for a later day for sure. Here's a quote. Let's get all biblical, because people often say, well, karma doesn't appear in the Bible. It's all over the Bible. It just isn't called karma, because that's a term from a different language. Uh-huh. Happy is the man whom God punishes, Job 5:17. Okay, and that reminds us, think back to when you were a kid and your parents would make you do awful things, like take medicine when you were sick and it tasted horrible and you didn't want to do it, and at the time it felt like you were being punished, but from the perspective of the parent, it was something that was going to make you feel better. Okay, to your perspective, it was a bad thing, but on a much higher perspective, it was a positive thing. Karma is the same way. We're supposed to be learning lessons. We're supposed to be perfecting ourselves. If we're never ever going to be, if our actions are never corrected, then we're continuing to do what we want, and we're going to continue to stray off the path. And that's what karma is all about. The law of balance must be maintained at all times. That's something you have to always keep in the back of your mind, especially when you're looking at a lot of these earlier classes we're going to talk about. Everything is the law of balance, and it's all around us. That's one of those universal laws that you really can't argue too much about. You always see balance, okay? There's the positive and there's the negative, and they're always reconciled by the neutral. There's always a balance there. If you want to get Christian, that's the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, right? If you want to get Egyptian, it's Isis, Osiris, and Horus. That whole concept of balance and perfection, we see that reflected all over the place. Every cause produces an effect. Every action has an equal and opposite reaction. This goes right back to Newton, right? Newton's laws of dynamics and emotion and all that kind of stuff. Every action has an equal and opposite reaction. Why is your butt not hitting the ground right now? Because your butt is exerting a certain amount of force that's being countered by the force of the chair. Therefore, you're in a balanced situation. You and the chair are going nowhere. It's the same thing. Every cause produces an effect. Every action has an equal and opposite reaction. Everything has a price and must be paid. Think of it that way. Okay? We must give in order to receive. Nothing is given as a gift. And this is one of the reasons why on the Gnostic path we don't charge for the teachings. Because if I want to receive higher knowledge, I have to be prepared to give what I know. Because it's by giving what I know that allows me to receive higher. Because if I keep taking and don't giving, that's not balanced. And the universe doesn't work like that. So if I keep trying to take, the universe will correct the balance by taking away. Okay, so you got to make sure that you're remembering that in your actions, you're trying to maintain that balance. And this has some big implications that we'll see today as well. Everything has a price and must be paid. We don't like that statement because we want everything for nothing. We want instant results without putting in any effort whatsoever. We do that in all different aspects of our lives, and you have to be really careful that when you look at your spiritual path, you're not trying to do the same thing. Okay? We're always trying to maintain a balance here. Nothing is given for free. The laws of return and recurrence, as well as the laws of evolution and involution, which we looked at last week, they're intimately related with the law of karma. And that's what we're going to see today. So this is kind of almost like a second part to where we left off last week. The law of cause and effect governs the course of our various existences, and each life is a result of the previous life that we lived. So we talked about return, we come back in a new body, right? And we basically do the same thing over and over again. Remember, we almost carry our life is like a movie script that we carry with each life. And when we die, it's like rewind and then play the whole movie again. Last week when we talked about that, we said that's basically the same except for the changes that are induced in each existence by the results of the law of karma. Each life, the things that happen to us, are rewards, which would be dharma, or punishments, you could call it, which would be karma, for things that we owed from the last life. The actions we do in this life are a debt that we have to pay the next time around, okay? Or a credit if we've lived properly. The circumstances into which we are born and everything that happens to us, from the zodiacal sign that you're born under, the family that you have, the location that you come into this physical world, the health of your physical body, the successes and failures of your life, they're determined by karma from past lives. So all the things that happen to you are a result of the things that you did in a previous existence. Yes?
Is there a consciousness behind karma?
Like at a universal level? Like not to be confused with our own consciousness?
No.
Yeah. Yeah, we're going to see that today. A lot of different cultures epitomize that consciousness in a different way. They give different faces to it. A lot of times the gods of the various religions were just faces or names put to levels of consciousness that operate some of the universal laws. And today we'll look at the consciousness, like, if you want to think of it that way, that governs karma, or the superior intelligence. I prefer superior intelligence over consciousness, because then you don't confuse it with the consciousness that we have, right? The consciousness being the higher self, the essence. So all the things that happen to us when we're born, when we come back into that new body, the circumstances into which we arrive, they're karmic. Everything from the zodiacal sign that we have, the type of family that we have, the environment that we grew up in, the people that are around us, the events that happen to us that shape our life in the first 7 years, they're karmic. Okay, so the different types of situations people find themselves in, as well as even looking at a larger scope of one's life, the various successes and failures that we have, the obstacles, the challenges that we have to overcome, as well as the rewards that we reap, they're determined by things that we've done in our past life. They're determined by karma from our past lives. Let's look at some really basic examples of karmic consequences, just to keep it simple. If in a past life we had an affair or took somebody else's partner, then in this life ours is going to be taken. We're going to be on the receiving end. Because that teaches us that what we did was wrong. We get to directly experience our own actions because we're supposed to learn from that. Okay? Let's look at another basic example. If we murdered somebody in a past life, in this life we find ourselves on the receiving end, the victim of a murder, something like that. Yes?
Is this like our last life to this life, or can it span across a number of different cycles?
It can span across a number of different cycles, and this is where this gets complicated, and there's no quick answer to that, because remember, we like to see things unfold in a very linear fashion related to time, and remembering once you go outside of the fourth dimension, there is no time. And that's another difficult thing. When we see somebody do bad things, we want to see them pay for it instantly, right? We say, well, we can all think of somebody that probably isn't living a very good life, but seems to be reaping rewards. Like, well, if there's karma, how come they're not, like, you know, crushed the next day under, or have something really bad to them? Because we want to see things happen in a linear fashion. Because remember, our perspective of time is it unfolds linearly. Once you get to the higher dimensions, everything's basically happening simultaneously, if that makes any sense at all. We just see things from a different perspective. So you got to keep that in mind as well, as how does the timeline work? Karma exceeds time. It's operating from such a higher level than that time doesn't really mean anything karmically.
And I think also our own egos, of us being hurt, we want to see that person be
hurt. Yeah, vengeance.
And that's also karmic.
Yes.
And it's about release, being able to release that to rise above it.
Yeah.
And that helps the other person release.
Yeah, which has bigger implications when we look at, you know, concepts like turn the other cheek, do unto others, mm-hmm. love thy enemy as thyself, that
kind
of stuff.
And that's where I'm understanding the concept that we truly are our brother's keepers, because when we do our own work and we free ourselves of things, we do free
yes.
others on the similar...
Yes, same thing, you know, Gandhi's saying, right? Be the change that you want to see in the world. Mm-hmm. That's the exact same concept. Exact same mm-hmm. concept. More silly examples. If we were bad parents, we were born to bad parents. And that's interesting, because many times we're shifting the role between parents and child across different existences as well, which is kind of interesting. So if we find ourselves in a situation where we complicated the lives of others, the next time we come around, we find ourselves on the receiving end of similar consequences. If we were a thief at some point, then we're a victim of theft. If we were wealthy and hoarded all our money, then we're find ourselves being born into a situation of poverty where we get to be on the receiving end of our own actions. It's two sides of the pendulum, right? It swings one side, then it swings the other. This is one side, this is the other side. And it's supposed to be teaching us a lesson. So these are all negative consequences. Obviously, karma doesn't have to be viewed as negative, because dharma could be reward. If we were perhaps wealthy and gave a lot to charity and helped others and improved the lives of others around us, the next time we're come around, we could be given a really good situation, so we can keep helping others and keep making a difference in the world. It doesn't always have to be viewed as negative, but when you look at these negative examples, it kind of reminds us that, boy, those really bad things that happen to us in life, we really need to reflect on them, and we really need to study them, because there's a lot of very important lessons that we can learn that can change the course of our existence. people don't understand the law, and they believe that everything that happens to us in life is predetermined beforehand. Now, you got to be careful here, because if you say, okay, well, if this life is governed by everything that I did in the last life, then if I did something bad in the last life, something bad is going to happen to me, and there's nothing that I'm going to do about it. That kind of sounds a bit like fate or destiny. That's actually not true. We're going to look at that, how that works today. You have to, at face value, not get caught in the trap that says, well, if I've done all this stuff, I've had all these lives before, and I don't even remember them, so I don't know what I did, and I probably had ego, so I probably did some bad stuff, so I guess I got bad stuff coming, so what's the point, what am I going to do anyway, right? There's a real tendency to do that, but what we're going to see today is we're look at some ways that how we can work with and actually change our karma, okay? We can't get too caught up in that concept of everything being predetermined, because if everything was predetermined, if there was fate and destiny, you have just taken away the concept of free will. So you can't have free will, yet have fate, destiny, and everything be predetermined, because they're exact opposite of each other. We know we have free will, so we have the opportunity to change. Okay, we have the opportunity to change the course of our lives. We just don't realize it many times, and we assume that it's predetermined. Okay, because we carry those same egos within us. It is true that our actions are determined by our environment. For example, I had a bad life growing up. I can't help the family I was born into. I can't help that I was born into, you know, a bad part of the world, or to a bad parents, or born into poverty or something. It's not my fault, and I really didn't have a lot of, you know, education opportunities and, you know, inherited behavior. You know, my dad, you know, beat up on my mom all the time, so I thought that that's the way you're supposed to treat them, and it's not my fault. Like, I don't have any control over this stuff. It is true that the environment which you're born into, yes, those things are there. So talking about bad parents, bad environment, which is the typical life of crime, and you see that in all the newspapers, right? That's the ultimate defense. Well, it wasn't their fault. They were beaten. They were abused. It was, you know, they did all these bad things to somebody else because, you know, they had a really bad life. We also have to remember that we always have a choice. No matter how much we think we don't, there's always a choice that's there, especially from a much higher perspective, especially from a universal or higher point of elevated consciousness. There's always a choice. We can choose to modify our actions, and we can fight against the situation that we've been placed in. Okay? Many times it can appear like we don't have a choice because that's the way the ego works. Well, this is, I have to do this, right? But remember the whole concept to working with self-observation. Self-observation was trying to be aware and stay in the present moment to see how the ego works. Because whenever we're self-observing, there's now a fork in the road. We can identify with the ego, or we can identify with the consciousness, the higher self. Okay, so let's say you say something right now to insult me. Most people would automatically get angry to that. Okay, or react with some sort of negative behavior. Okay, it seems like, well, it's not my fault. You said those horrible things about me. What? You said them. Okay, that's identifying with the ego. You insult me, I get angry, that's the end of the reaction. Okay, if I'm self-observing, you assault or you insult me, and I have a choice. I think, okay, that makes me want to react with anger. Why? Who are you? What value do your words have? Okay, remember when somebody assaults you, the value or strength of their words is whatever you assign to them. Okay, so if I'm self-observing, when somebody says something negative about me, I can feel that anger, but I can choose not to go with it. I can say, you know what? I don't want to be angry. I'm not going to let you control me. Who are you anyway? Who are you to me? And I can choose another path. Yes?
That's just like so hard to do.
Yes.
What happens when the person is like your friend or your boyfriend or your family and they say something really hurtful and how do you deal with that?
There's a key. This is a little bit of a later class, but we can touch on it right now. There's a whole key. Because you've heard concepts in the Bible like turn the other cheek, do unto others as you have them. These things seem so hard. Love thy neighbor. Like, I don't want to love strange people on the street. You're supposed to love the most those who hurt you the most. Like, where do these concepts come from? Let's use anger. So you've insulted me. You're somebody very important to me, or you mean something a lot to me, and you insult me, and I want to get angry, okay? If I have truly comprehended anger in myself, if I have truly understood anger, if I have studied it, if I have comprehended it in all the different levels of my mind, you don't react to it. that's the thing that's difficult for, and that's that mind space that's difficult to put ourselves in, because we haven't studied the ego a lot. If you really study the behavior in your own mind, then you can excuse the behavior in other people. So if I've really studied anger, as an example, and somebody's trying to insult me, I can say, you know what? Boy, that person's really angry right now. They don't know what they're saying. They don't know what's coming over them. Man, anger's a tough one. I can remember times that I got angry. But, you know, I've been able to eliminate that anger. There's nothing there to react. You're thinking, well, it's really hard because the ego is in you. It wants to react. But if you eliminate that from your psychology, then there is literally nothing to respond to that anger. Someone's trying to push a button, and there's nothing there to push. That's the key. And it's so hard to visualize and imagine what that would be like, because it's something we carry within ourselves. But if we can remove it from ourselves, then there's nothing there. A famous story. So the Buddha's meditating under a tree, and somebody comes by and starts insulting him. And, look at you, stupid, sitting under that tree, sitting around all day meditating, get a job, you're lazy, whatever. And then Buddha simply stops the meditation and opens his eyes and says to the person, my brother, what do you do when somebody gives you a gift that you don't want? And the person who's insulting the Buddha says, well, you just tell him to take it back. And Buddha looks at him and says, well, please take your gift and leave. Closes his eyes and goes back into the meditation. Okay? Because that's the thing. The Buddha was not wanting to receive that negative energy. You see something similar if you study any kind of martial arts, especially Kung Fu. They have a philosophy, which is you don't ever hit somebody, you don't ever kick somebody, you just choose to not accept their punch or their kick, and you give it back to them. You're just directing that energy back rather than receiving it. Yes?
Now, when you have that option, that fork you said, is that the only way to know? Like when you always say, is that like, and do you ever really know that? Or like, can your ego attach on to that knowing of that?
No, because to self...
Is that your essence knowing?
Yeah, if you're properly self-observing, if you're going to really watch yourself, to properly self-observe, you're going to create a split into the observer and the observed. That which is being watched and that which is doing the watching. That which is being watched, by definition, has to be the ego. That which is doing the watching, by definition, has to be the consciousness. Yeah, so you can create a delineation. And that's why self-observation is so important, because it allows you to really get a sense of, well, is this my ego or is this my consciousness? How do I tell the difference?
So even that question is like...
And that's why self-observation is, that's why we keep talking about that. It's such an important technique. Yes?
What about situations where you have no other scenario for you? For example, the theft example you used beforehand. What if you were born into a life of poverty and you had to steal to survive, in order, like hunger, you had to do it.
We're going
to
hold that thought, because we're going to look at that specifically, about that. That's a really good question, and there's a specific point we'll look at later on that directly affects that. So we always have a choice, no matter how often. Don't think you have a choice, there's always a choice, because we have free will. That's the concept of free will, the concept of choice. Let's look at the judges of the law, because this goes back to your question earlier. Is there some kind of intelligence or some kind of governing body or consciousness behind the law? The Egyptians had a really great way of looking at this. They looked at the intelligences or the entities that governed this law, and they referred to them as judges. The chief priest, the head consciousness, was the great master Anubis. Okay, and Anubis was the jackal-headed god. And all the Egyptians are doing here is just trying to personify a universal principle. Right? They're just trying to put a face to some kind of universal law or universal intelligence. And they have a really great way of looking at the whole process of karma. In addition to Anubis, there was 42 judges. Okay, there was 21 on the side of justice and 21 on the side of mercy. So they set up this balance. There's 21 judges on the side of justice, 21 on the side of mercy. So they set up this really interesting way of looking at the whole law of karma. And they did a really good job of putting into principle some of these things that we can really understand or that have a lot of relevance into what we're doing in modern times. This is the weighing of the heart ceremony, and this is how the Egyptians depicted the whole process of karma. So what we have right here is the master Anubis. Anubis seen as the god, for lack of a better term, of karma. And Anubis is here, he's adjudicating the scales. Now on the scales is a feather on one side, and in this jar was supposed to be our heart. And it was said that after we died, our heart was weighed against the feather, suggesting if our heart was heavier than the feather, it contained a lot of dark, a lot of bad stuff. But if our heart was lighter than the feather, it must be pure and clean. Okay, so there's a Master Nubis sitting before the scales. This person right here, this is the Divine Mother. We talked about the Divine Mother last week, right? We talked about our higher self having basically two parts, a positive and a negative, or a male and a female, the Divine Mother and our Father. Okay, this is our essence. It's the falcon with the head on it. The Egyptians always depicted the soul or the essence like that. It was a falcon with a human head. So there's our consciousness that's, of course, bound to the whole concept because our consciousness is attached to the ego, and this is what's being judged right now. The Master Nubis weighing everything. Now this guy right here, this is the Ibis of Thoth. Now he's reading, he's like a scribe. He's like a one that was a note taker. He represents our conscience. He's reading back a list of all the right things and the wrong things that we did. Okay, so he's the little, you know, the comical, you know, the angel on one shoulder, devil on the other. That's how they depicted this guy. He's the guy that took down all those things that we did that we knew we weren't supposed to do. Now, in this process, what happens is the heart is weighed against the feather. If the heart is heavier than the feather, then everything was thrown to this guy right here. And this is Amut, the devourer of the dead. He's a rather unpleasant character. He represents the wheel of samsara. He represents the mechanical forces of nature. If our heart was too heavy, because it was full of all those wrong action, then the essence is tossed to him, and it's sent back into the physical body again, to have another life, to once again come before the lords of karma, and be judged for our actions once again. Okay, so we can see the same story. We've got the Divine Mother, we've got the consciousness, we've got karma, the whole concept of balance in the universe, the heart, our good actions or bad actions, being weighed against the feather, our actions being, of course, recorded, you know, do what thou wilt, but know that we must account for all our actions, idea being here that there somebody is taking record of them, somebody being the universe itself, and they're going to be reflected back to us. And then if we don't live properly, if we accrue too much negative karma, then we stay bound to this physical existence. We stay bound to the physical plane, and of course the whole process up here, these guys are your 21 judges seen across the top. Okay, so the Egyptians had this really colorful way of looking at the law of karma. And now, taking what we've learned here into account for the rest of the class, we're going to see how we can pull some really interesting bits of information to help understand karma better, but also help to understand how we can use some of these things to our advantage, how we can direct the ship of our life or steer the course of the ship of our life in a much more beneficial direction. Now, paying and accruing karma. Every bad action we do, everything that's negative, everything that's impelled from ill will, is a letter that we sign or agree to pay in the following life. It's almost like an IOU, let's think of it that way, right? The idea being that we are responsible for our actions. There's no getting away from this, okay? The universe isn't going to cut us any deals here. Everything that we do, we have to pay for at some point. You can also think of life as a chess game in which every action of ours is a move. Everything that we do on that chessboard is a move. And every move affects the final outcome of the game, right? Early on in the game, you make the wrong move. That sometimes is immediately apparent if somebody takes the man, or sometimes that wrong move is something that costs you the game much further down the road. If the moves that we make in this game are intelligent and opportune, then the outcome is success, health, and longevity. Positive things. And that's what was referred to as dharma. Okay? When good things come back to us, we say we're receiving dharma. We're reaping the benefits of things that we've done. If the moves that we make in life are impelled by ill will, selfish, or just inopportune, then the outcome will be failure, sickness, death, all the negative things, and that's karma. Okay, so karma and dharma are basically the same thing. Our actions follow us. But as humans, we go when it's bad actions following us, we go karma. When it's good things, we call it dharma. Okay, but it's really just two sides of the same coin here. Okay, so we do the right thing at the right time for the right reasons, then success, longevity, and all kinds of beneficial things. Okay, we do the wrong thing at the wrong time for the wrong reasons, then that's going to cost us. Okay? How would you define the difference between the right thing at the right time and the wrong thing at the wrong time? How are you supposed to know the difference between the two?
You'd have to be outside of yourself.
Kind of not quite, though.
Be conscious?
Why?
So you know. Would you say the question again, sorry?
So we're saying, okay, if you do the right thing for the right reason at the right time, positive things happen. If you do the wrong thing for the wrong reason at the wrong time, negative things happen.
Risk free will.
How am I supposed to know what the right thing at the right time is?
For me, I feel a sense of lightness, and that comes from my practice of meditation and knowing myself.
Even at a much greater level than that. This is consciousness, ego. Mm-hmm. Okay, or soul, essence, divine side, and then the ego. Mm-hmm.
And when you're listening to your conscience and following that conscious action, it's a knowing and it's a lightness of being.
Mm-hmm.
Versus when you're going with ego, it's heavier. And through meditation, self-observation, you start
being able to distinguish the difference. And that's the key, mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Yeah.
That's why we do things like meditation and self-observation. Because in the beginning, how do you know the difference? Because they almost seem the same. Remember, that's the big thing of the ego. What's the greatest trick the devil played on humanity? Was convincing you that you exist in the first place. Right?
What if you follow your essence, but you end up hurting someone?
What if you follow your essence? See, that's the thing. Your higher self, your consciousness, isn't able to do anything like that. And if that person was, this is a strange thing to think about, but if that person was hurt as a result, that would be karma that they were paying that you weren't. Right? Because we're all kind of woven in this really intricate web, which is kind of a strange thing to think about.
So if somebody were to... If you told someone the truth about a bad situation and they went and shot themselves... that would be due to their own egos.
Wow.
That's heavy.
Would that be due to their own ego?
What we have to look at, we'll have another situation that we'll bring up in a few minutes. It's a very similar example to that.
What if?
Yeah, well, what you have to look at in a situation like that is, what was your impulse to tell the person? Right? And hold that thought, because we're gonna go there in a second.
And I think we always have to remember to not, our egos will fool us into thinking it's our consciousness that we're using. And that is why the key is self, it starts with
self-observation. You're going to be so sick of hearing me say that. Yeah.
And the meditation, because that's how you'd be able to start really...
Is being able to hear the difference, absolutely, yes.
Yeah, because even if you like do self-observe like a little bit, you know what I mean, like people like... You know, get up a little bit, that fallen angel thing, you know?
Mm-hmm.
You just, like, if you catch on, like, one ego, like, if you, like, say if you have the fork in the road.
Yeah.
And there's, like, I don't know how big it has to be, but if you just say, you know, ego today, you know, oh, how that works? You fall right off, you know? You know, I'm wording that right. I'm trying to, like, say what I'm thinking right now. It's hard.
Yeah, I'm not sure.
Okay, I'll think about that one for a while.
Okay. Okay. Let's look at it this way as well. When we think about, you know, accruing karma or being responsible for actions, we receive karma not only for the bad stuff that we do, the negative things, but also for the good that one fails to do as well. So there's a trap. Sometimes you say, I don't do anything negative in my life, but sometimes there's so many situations we had the ability to do something positive. We had the ability to help or improve the lives of others around us or contribute, and we chose not to. That's karmic as well. Okay, so that's something else to be careful about. We can say, well, I don't really do anything bad. I don't walk around like punching people in the face and stealing stuff and taking other people's partners. So, hey, I'm good, right? But remember that there's so many positive things that we have the ability to do that we choose, it's always a choice, that we choose not to do. Okay, so karma isn't just for negative actions. Karma is also for good that one fails to do. And that's the story of the Good Samaritan in the Bible, right? All those people that passed the person on the road suffering and the one person stopped to help. You could say, well, all those other people were receiving negative karma. And that's something that we do that's another huge problem in society that they've actually done psychological studies on. They've set up situations where somebody is hurt, trying to recreate that. And what they've discovered is, if you see another human being in the vicinity, you will not do anything because you'll think it's that person's problem. And that gets more and more problematic the more people you introduce. Most people, if it's one-on-one, will actually stop to help the person. But if there's somebody else in the vicinity, you just turn a blind eye to it. And that's something that we have ingrained in our psychology because of the ego. So there's many times in life that we are in a situation to make a contribution. Doesn't mean you have to save somebody from dying, but a contribution. We can help or improve the lives of others around us, but we've chosen not to because for whatever reason, because we put our own needs before others. Because I didn't stop, I was in a hurry, I didn't have enough time, I needed that money for something else, whatever. We all have a rationalization or an excuse to that too. The other thing to mention, this is really difficult to swallow sometimes, we are judged on deeds, not intentions. Okay? It's not what you wanted, it's what happened. Okay? It's the outcome that happens, not what you're intending to do. Okay? It doesn't matter how well-intentioned you were, if your actions lead to something negative, that's your karma. Let's look at it, and everyone kind of furrows their brow and goes, there's no way. If I was intending to help somebody, and then something bad happened, there's no way I could be responsible for that. This is a really good example of this. There was this man that had some really good intentions for his country. He was going to create a utopia. He introduced a welfare system. He introduced an unemployment system. He introduced free education. He brought almost ended poverty and child education and all this kind of stuff. He was a forerunner for creating hospitals and other systems. He was trying to create a perfect world for his people. He was called Adolf Hitler. Okay? That man had some very good intentions with what he was trying to do. But do you think he went before the judge of the karma and said, I was trying to do some really good things, and they're like, oh, okay, you're cool, all right, you know. It doesn't work like that, right? It was the outcome that he was responsible for, not the intention. Okay? This is a paradox that I'll give you, and this is something to think about. It doesn't necessarily, we won't discuss it too much, because it gets pretty deep. Let's say I'm going out for supper tonight. And I have a lady friend that I've just met and I want to make a really good impression on. And let's say that on the way to going out to supper, I have to swing by the vending machine and pick up some money. So there's me and my lady friend. I'm going to take her out for dinner. We're going to get a nice dinner. We're going to have a few drinks. But I stop by the vending machine on the way there. And as I walk to the bank, I see a homeless person sitting in the street. And while I'm in the vending machine and I take up my money, I think, you know that guy there, he's got nothing. I can take all this money out and all that kind of stuff. And I really doubt so much. So let's say I give this homeless man $100. Now let's say that homeless man then either A, scenario one, let's say, goes out, buys a handgun, tries to pull up a liquor store, shoots a liquor store owner dead, or B, goes and buys more crack cocaine or heroin than they're able to and overdoses. The question is, how responsible am I for those two outcomes? Now your gut impulse is to say, well, not at all, because you were just trying to help him. Because, you know, you're trying to be charitable. There's no way that could come back on you. What you have to ask, what were my intentions? Why was I being charitable? Was I being charitable because my essence or my consciousness was speaking through me so I could help that person? Or was I being charitable so I could impress that young girl? Was I being charitable because I felt guilty because I was going to blow $200 on a really fancy meal and a lot of money so maybe be able to sleep with some girl? Okay, you have to ask, what were the intentions behind the action? Was it an action that comes from the consciousness and the higher self, which would be then following the will of our Father, playing into the whole framework of the universe? Or is this an action impelled by another side of me? Guilt, fear, anger, envy, jealousy, lust. These are all the things that can play onto a given action. And that's what you have to ask yourself, which goes back to your question earlier. What if you told somebody something and then they went and shot themselves in the head? Then are you responsible for that? What was your reason to tell them? And that's the question that you have to answer yourself. Were you telling somebody because you wanted to say, I told you so, because you wanted to look so much better than them? What's your reasoning? And that's why self-observation is so important, because in that situation, how do you know if it's your consciousness or if it's your ego? Because nobody in that situation nobody would say, hey, I'm going to give that homeless guy money because that's going to make this me look really good in front of that girl and maybe she'll want to sleep with me. Nobody's thought process really goes like that. Some people do, but they don't. Remember that the ego works subconsciously. It's a reaction. Homeless person, girl, ooh, I'm going to give them money. You don't really have that whole chain of thought that leads up to that, which is why it's important to work with self-observation and to be able to discern the difference between the will of the higher self and the will of the ego. Because in the end, it's not what we are attempting to do, it's what happened. Yes?
Okay, because what you just said seems like a contradiction to me.
Okay.
Because you're saying, if you gave the guy for money for good intentions,
mm-hmm.
but those option A or option B happened, that's the deed, that's the end that
mm-hmm.
happened. So that says judged on deeds, so you're bad even though your intention was good, but you just mm-hmm. said your intention mattered.
You have to see a little bit deeper into it than that. If you're, okay, if you're going with the will of the consciousness, and this is something we haven't really had a chance to go too far into yet, the consciousness comes from the higher dimensions, right? Our higher self is from the higher dimensions, okay? It's a part of us that's in, or comes from heaven, if you want to think of it on a Christian context. That exceeds time. It's able to see action and consequence. The consciousness knows, give that homeless person money because they're going to go home and they're going to buy food for their family. Don't give that homeless person money because I can see that if they do that, this is going to happen. Okay? And we've all experienced this. We get this regularly. It's a sense of intuition, a gut feeling. Okay? We've all been in a situation where we've got a gut feeling not to do something. We went against it and went, oh, I didn't listen to my gut. Your gut instinct, that intuition, that comes from your higher self. That's communication from your higher self. It's able to see that, hey, if, you know, dark alley, it's raining at night, and you're walking home, you could take the long way and go around the corner, but there's that dark alley that's a shortcut, save a few minutes, get you home quicker, it's cold, it's raining, you go down the dark alley and you get that gut instinct, I don't think I should do that. That's because your higher self can see what's going to happen next. It's at a different vantage point. Imagine you standing on the top of a skyscraper looking down going, oh, if you go down that alley and go here, there's a crazy gang of thugs that are going to rob you. It's a different vantage point, a different perspective. You at street level can't see what's around the corner. Okay, so if you're working with the consciousness, then it's going with the laws of the universe. It's going with the will of the higher self, which is the way things are supposed to go. We keep screwing all that up by doing whatever we want and not listening to it. You have to look at it from that context. As a famous saying, road to hell is paved with good intentions. That's why that's true. Because it's not the intentions, it's the problem, it's the deed itself. It's what the outcome is. Okay, so you can't necessarily fool yourself into saying, well, I'm really trying to do good things here, and the best example of that is exactly what Hitler was trying to do. Okay, he was trying to make utopia for his people. He did some really amazing things. The concept of like welfare and stuff like that we use was started back then by him and his government. But there's all kinds of horrible monstrosities came out of those good intentions. Yeah.
Like Hitler was the most recent and worst example of all those kind of people, but like Julius Caesar, Napoleon, Alexander the Great, they're all like the same level.
Yeah, for one group of people. For one group of people they were trying to do something really good, but to a whole bunch of other people.
Oh yeah, check out the latest version. They exist. They're out there all over the place, leaders. We're hearing about it more and more every day.
And don't forget that we have a tendency, it's not necessarily gonna manifest, but we have a tendency to do that in ourselves. Just on different, obviously not as a huge a scale, but at a different kind of scale, we have a tendency to do the same thing, and we've all kind of experienced that at different points in our life. We have to remember we shouldn't be protesting against karma. When negative things happen to us, we are reaping what we have sown. We are responsible for our own actions. Yet when we're on the receiving end, it's somebody else's fault. Very rarely will we accept the consequences of our actions, which causes us to miss many opportunities in life, because the negative things are opportunities that we can really use to learn a lot more about the egos that we carry, learn a lot more how to perfect ourselves, and prevent the same situation from manifesting again. But we don't tend to do that. We just want to get out of it. It's like a oh, woe is me kind of situation, and we just look for ways to get out of it. We don't look for a way to really understand it and then permanently shift that course. We just want to get out of it somehow, right? And can't really see why we're in this situation, because as far as we're concerned, we're perfect. Remembering that there's one golden idol that we all bow down to every day, there's one false god we continually worship, and that's the false idol of the self. We're all perfect. We put ourselves up on a pedestal, and I don't know why bad things would happen to me. I mean, you guys, I would understand, because I mean, look at you. I can see why all kinds of bad things would happen, but me, no way. So when something negative happens, we tend to go, you know, oh, woe is me. I don't know what I did to deserve this. But really, we should go, okay, I'm going to really look deep inside myself to see what I might carry within me that was responsible for this action. Okay, how is this? This is obviously something that I carry within that I'm now on the receiving end of. More biblical quotes. I love throwing out the biblical quotes because karma doesn't really appear in the Bible as karma, so the Christians tend to get a little bit weird and say, well, it doesn't talk about it in the Bible. It's all over the place. With the same measurement that we measure others, we will be measured. Okay, so however we judge others, that's how we're going to be judged as well. We also tend to hold people to situations and circumstances and levels that we don't hold ourselves to. We regularly excuse in our own behavior, our excuse in our own personality, sorry, in our own life, behaviors we don't tolerate for an instant in other people. We tend to do that, and that reminds us of the consequences of that. Here's another one. Let no one cheat himself. What a human being will sow will be harvested, and his actions will follow him. Galatians 6:7. I mean, that's an excellent definition of karma. It's not called karma because that's a word from a different culture, right? But there you go. That's karma right there. What a human being will sow will be harvested, and his actions will follow him. So we do get to reap what we sow. Now let's look at the whole process of managing and dealing with karma, because we've seen that karma is just simply a reaction. Yes?
Before we get to that, I have a small question.
Okay.
Karma and dharma, is that balanced the same way the scales are, or is it simply the goal is to get as little karma as possible, as much dharma as possible?
Yeah, you could think of it that way, minimizing your karma. So
okay.
Minimizing the negative and increasing the positive.
Or is it a balance of, like, get to a net zero?
Not really a net zero, because we have to account for the huge imbalance that we've already done. And that leads into what we're going to be talking about here. How do we account for some of this karma already? How do we balance our own scales? Because in the end, that's what we want. We want to basically eliminate this.
So the goal in the end would be to balance that.
Yeah. Yeah. So no, nothing, no set anything, right? Just perfect equilibrium. That's what we're trying to do. And you have to remember to think of it just like a mirror. Whatever you project out, that's what's coming back.
So I thought of a cool thing. Like, you remember that? I can't remember who it is, but that Greek person holds a rope.
Atlas? Yeah.
Yeah, that guy. Thought about it, balance.
I don't know if that pertains to karma, but yeah, taking the weight of your world on your shoulders, why not? Okay, so this ties into the concept we talked about earlier, the idea being that everything's predetermined, you know, destiny, fate, there's nothing I can do about it. So a lot of times when people think a bit about karma, you reflect on karma, you can jump to the mistaken assumption that karma unfolds in a mechanical, automatic, and cruel manner. That there is no way to possibly alter it. Okay, so let's say that I have done something negative, and I'm thinking, okay, well, that's it. I'm just on the receiving end of that, the next life. There's nothing that I can do. Okay, that concept, once again, takes away free will and brings up concepts like fate, destiny, and predetermined. So the idea, if I do something wrong, there's nothing I can do about it, I'm just going to have to receive it when it comes later on. That suggests that karma unfolds in a mechanical, automatic, and kind of a cruel sort of a manner to it. If this was so, if that's the situation how things happen, then there wouldn't be the possibility of divine mercy, which then suggests the universe is only negative and cruel. So if I do something bad today, what I'm trying to say here is there's nothing I can do for that. I've done something bad. Forget it. There's nothing I can do. I'm just going to be on the receiving end of something negative because I screwed up. Okay? If that was the way things were, then that twists everything to the negative. It suggests that the concept of divine mercy can't exist and suggests that everything is just negative and cruel. There's no way we can really modify the circumstances at all. Let's look at it this way. Justice without mercy is tyranny. Mercy without justice is tolerance and complacency. They both have to exist because the universe is balanced. That's why you look at those concepts. Okay? Justice without mercy is tyranny. And mercy without justice is tolerance and complacency. So there has to be the room for both here. It's scales. They can go both sides. If I do something bad today and then there's nothing I can do to rectify the situation, it's going to come back to me negative, that would be tyranny. Okay? Justice without mercy would be tyranny. But if you do something bad and then you don't have to do anything to correct that and everything's going to be okay in the end, that's tolerance and complacency. And when we look at the Tree of Life, which you'll get sick of me doing because you really don't get into this until later, in the course, but if you have any background in Kabbalah and the Tree of Life, you have the middle pillar right here, which is your pillar of balance, and then you have the two pillars either side, one for severity and one for mercy. Okay, so there's a point of balance, and then there's the two opposing sides. Okay, severity and mercy, which is a similar concept that we're looking at right here. So justice without mercy is tyranny. That's one extreme. The other extreme is mercy without justice is tolerance and complacency. There's got to be a balance to both of these. These are human defects. When we talk about awakened masters, and we talked about some sort of a universal consciousness, God, for lack of a better term, you want to call it Allah, you want to call it Brahma, you want to call it the void, you want to call it the source of all things, it doesn't matter. Tyranny, mercy, justice, these are labels that we put on things, just like good and evil. Okay, from a concept of an awakened consciousness, as I mentioned earlier, there's no such thing as good and evil. There's what is and what will come. We want to put labels on things. So we want to say that one is bad and one is good, but from a universal standpoint, from an awakened consciousness standpoint, it's really not so black and white. To modify the effect, we have to change the cause. So let's say I've done something bad, and I'm thinking, okay, well, what am I supposed to do here? If I do something bad, does that mean something automatically is going to happen to me later on that's bad? Is that kind of how karma works? We said, well, that's one extreme. That's like a negative kind of thing that doesn't suggest in any way that we can alter the circumstances, which would mean the universe only shifts to one polarity. There's got to be some sort of a balance here. To modify the effect, we have to change the cause. Let's say that I've done something really negative. Let's say, I don't know, I've taken another man's wife. So that means the next life, mine's going to be taken, right? Or does it? How could I modify that? Let's look at that example of me taking another man's wife. What was the cause there? What was the cause behind that? What part of me made me do that? Was that the consciousness?
The ego.
The ego. That's a really, and specifically the ego of lust. Now that's a really important observation. Okay? And this is a statement. Now this gets a little weird. You can, one that develops faculties like astral projection and works with developing consciousness in the higher worlds, you can communicate directly with some of the intelligences that work with the law of karma, some of those judges, okay, the gods, so to speak. Okay, this is something that everybody is capable of doing. And one of the things that Master Samael, the guy on the wall here, that brought a lot of the Gnosis into modern times, one of the things that he was doing was trying to explain, or going into the higher dimensions, talking with some of these intelligences, and trying to figure out how to explain to humanity how we can work with karma. And this is something that you can verify with yourself as well. An advanced use of karma, this is a thing that we'll get into much later, is you can actually go to a certain point in the higher dimensions, and you've all heard the concept of the book of life before. You have a book of your deeds and actions. That's just a depiction for being able to see your own karma. Okay, see what you have to pay and how to manage that. That's for your book of life, deeds, the actions that you have to do. Okay, remember that Ibis of Toth, the guy that was judging you, the weighing of the heart ceremony, literally seeing what you're able to do, okay, which is also related to the concept of the Akashic Records. You ever heard of that before? Mm-hmm. That you can go into higher dimensions and see any point in time, past, present, or future? That's the same thing as being able to read your karma. Think of it kind of like the internet of the higher dimensions. It's like almost like a type of technology, for lack of a better term. Now, one of the things that Master Anubis, which is the intelligence that governs karma, you can think of him as a god, because that's what the ancient people thought of it. You could think of his intelligence or consciousness or whatever, or principle. When talking to Master Samael about karma, this is something that he told us. So this comes from the gods in the higher dimensions. This comes from Anubis himself. The line of the law is combated with the scales. Now, what does that possibly mean? This important statement gives us the knowledge of how we can eliminate karma and prevent suffering. So the line of the law, there's the meaning of a lion charging at you, right? It's ferocious, it's severe. So the line of the law, the negative side, it doesn't say, you know, the evil, the bad stuff, because that's our judgment. It's just the lion, the strict, severe side. The line of the law is combated with the scales. That tells us how we can learn to manage and negotiate our karma. What this is basically saying is we can eliminate our karma by doing good and tipping the scales in our favor. We can correct our own actions by canceling out the negative with the positive. we're able to modify the circumstances of our life by understanding the concept of balance. Okay? If we have the negative actions that we've done, the idea that, well, there's nothing I can do about those negative actions, they're going to come back on me always as negative, that once again suggests that we have this kind of tyranny and this suffering and this negative stuff that we can't ever fix. What this is talking about is by understanding that karma is simply balance, once the scales have tipped one side, we just have to stack them the other side. Tipping the scales in our favor, we can eliminate our negative aspects of karma by doing positive. Okay, and that's a really interesting statement. The karma we pay depends on how much the scales tip towards the negative. The universe reflects back whatever we project. If we're constantly reflecting negative, then negative is coming back. If we have some negative and then a whole bunch of positive, then we get, which is what Peter was talking about earlier, those scales being perfectly balanced. Okay, think of, you know, pushed in one direction and then pushed the equal amount in the direction, you haven't gone anywhere. One step forward, one step backward, net movement is zero. Yeah.
Is that the same lion that appears in alchemy? Like when they talk about the lion and the...
It's different. Sun. Yeah, that's a whole different thing. We'll get into that much later. Yeah.
I think we have to be careful, though, too, with just doing good, 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 because we have to, if there's that intention behind it, too. Because we can't just do good for the basis of avoiding our karma, because it's still going to come back, and the good is with the proper intention, because the good could be bad.
Yeah, excellent observation. That's the catch. Doing good for the proper reasons, right? Not just going, okay, I'm going to steal a bunch of stuff, and then I'm going to cut a whole lot of old lady's grass this summer because it's going to totally cancel out, right? It doesn't quite work like that. What were the intentions? Okay, it all comes back to the intentions. Look at it this way. We can eliminate the stuff that the ego caused us by instead doing things that come from the consciousness. The more time we spend self-observing and working with the consciousness, then the more we're tipping those scales in the favor. We work with the consciousness, that's like putting coins on one side of the scale. We work with the ego, that's like putting coins on the other side of the scale. At the end of our life, it's really what have we done more of? Identify with the ego and do all these wrong things, these actions impelled by ill will and all this negative stuff, or have we done positive things, actions impelled by our consciousness, our soul, our higher self, for lack of a better term. Okay, that's what it comes down to. The line of the law is combated with the scales. Understanding how the balance works means we can change the cause, modifying the effect to change the cause. If our good actions outweigh the bad, then we receive dharma instead of karma. Okay, so if we do more positive than negative, then the net result is positive things that happen. If we do more negative than positive, then the net result is negative things that happen. And if you think of, these are the things that color the course of our life. If all we've done is negative, 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 or impelled, or things by that are impelled by the ego and all that dark stuff, then the tone, the color of our life is going to be the ego, the dark stuff, and the negative things. Okay? If we work with the consciousness and work with the higher self and do positive things, then the overall scope of our life and our existence will be positive things as well. We have to cancel old debts to avoid suffering by doing good deeds. Okay, so we have to try to cancel the old debts, the things, because we don't remember, right? We don't know what we did our last life. How do we know what we're responsible for? An advanced practice, as I mentioned earlier, is getting to go into the higher dimensions using things like astral projection to actually see what we have to account for, to see the karma that we owe. But in the meantime, we can modify our circumstances by choosing instead to identify with the higher self, the consciousness, and do good things rather than negative things. Because that will drastically alter the course of not only this existence, but other existences to come as well. This is another quote coming from the higher dimensions again. So we had the line of the law was combated with the scales. The next statement they gave us was this one. Do good deeds so that you can pay your debts. Just seen as a universal, almost like debt and credit kind of system, which is a really interesting way of looking at that. Do good deeds so that you may pay your debt. So when something is owed, when some energy is coming at you, call it negative energy, do you have anything positive to deflect that, to cancel that? Yes or no? If there's more positive coming at you, if there's more negative coming at you than positive you're sending out, then you're going to receive some of that negative. if you've got some negative coming at you, but you're sending way more positive out, then the positive is going to cancel the negative. Okay, it's just a simple, like, okay, if you owe me $100 and I come looking for it, if you got $200 in your pocket, you can easily give me the $100 and I walk away. If you owe me $100 and I come for it, you don't have any money, now you got a problem because you have a debt that's owed. It's basically the same way. And this is, like I said, coming right from the higher dimensions, right from the levels of the intelligences that govern the concept of karma itself, trying to explain it to us in human terms that we understand. Further to that statement, he who has the capital with which to pay, pays and comes out well in his dealing. He who does not have the means to pay, pays with pain. Okay, so once again, coming from Master Anubis, coming from the higher dimensions, the personification of karma itself. They who have the capital with which to pay, the good deeds, the capital, pay and comes out well in their dealings. They who do not have the capital to pay, the means with which to pay that debt with suffering. Okay, the idea being stacking the deck in our favor, tipping the scales, trying to do positive, to do good, to cancel out the negative that we've done. And that's how we manage our karma. So the idea being, if I've done something a year ago, I did something really bad, okay, is this always going to be bad, or no matter what, I'm going to have negative things come to me? No, not necessarily. If I know how to properly manage, if I know how to not identify with the ego, and instead work with my consciousness to correct for those actions. Okay, we can correct our actions. We can modify the cause if we understand this concept. Okay, but to really understand this concept, it's not as simple as, you know, going, okay, well, I'm just going to give. I did something really bad a few years ago, so I'm going to give to charity, or I'm going to, you know, help feed homeless people or something like that, which goes back to the question that you made earlier, this idea being, well, the intention has to be good. Doing good for good's sake, not to get out of something. Okay, so there's a loophole, there's a little bit of a danger there that we can fall into, which once again comes back to that concept of, well, how do I know what really good is? That belongs to the consciousness. That's why self-observation is so important. If you don't get to learn the voice of our higher self, our consciousness, we'll never know when it's speaking. And right now that's the problem with being human. How do you discern the difference between the ego and all its motives and the consciousness, the higher self, and what it wants us to do? And that's the challenge. That's why self-observation is such an important technique. And that's why you guys have been doing this regularly for the past couple of weeks, because you've been doing that thing where every day you pick the activity, like tying your shoes or driving to work or showering, and you decided in that moment you were going to stay conscious and stay in the present moment and observe what you're thinking, feeling, and doing, right? Of course, because you've all been doing that. Now, this is further to this as well. This is a really interesting one. When an inferior law is transcended by a superior law, the superior washes away the inferior. Now, this is a difficult one to understand. So I think it was you asked the question earlier. Okay, what if I'm stealing bread, but I'm stealing bread to feed my starving children? Then is that karmic or not? That's what this statement addresses. The inferior law, those are the laws of man, okay? Because many of our laws are simply, they're almost like customs. They're dependent upon...
I see those guidelines.
Yeah, well, guidelines. They're dependent upon cultures. It's the zeitgeist of the time that determines what's legal and what's illegal. And many times it's not only the zeitgeist of the time, it's also the culture, the geographic location, the background. Like, look at the laws we have in Canada and look at some of the laws that, you know, like the Shia law of the Muslims. Those are crazy laws. What's going on here? The inferior law are the laws of man. The superior law is karma. So somebody who's stealing bread to feed their family, let's say it's a father who's stealing bread to save his starving children, you know, his wife was sick and then passed away, and he's destitute, and he's stealing bread to save his children. Well, is he suffering karma then? Well, no, because stealing the bread is the inferior law. He's breaking the laws of man to uphold the superior law, providing a raise for his children. Okay? Yes?
So, would it be that you had to recognize that the reason why you're in poverty is maybe because of the past lifetime where you were hoarding money, that sort of thing? And if you recognize that and realize that I have to do this out of necessity, is that give you the ability to then transcend forward
in
the next lifetime?
Remember, it's all the impulse. What was the impulse of behavior?
Like, if I go out and steal somebody's bike, the impulsive behavior is, I am coveting that bike. I want, I desire that bike because I want what that bike brings, a nice fancy bike or whatever, I'm lazy. Somebody who's stealing food for the children is not like, I'm stealing food because, when that's a really sweet loaf of bread and I look so good carrying this loaf of bread. It's a different impulse. The impulse there is to care for the children. And that's what it comes down to. If you think of an action, you're doing anything. What is the impulse for that action? Because we are just puppets. Right? We're puppets that dance to the tune of the puppet master. Who is the puppet master? You doing an action is a manifestation of a personality. The personality is either, it's a vehicle, it's a car, right? That personality is either driven by the ego or it's driven by the consciousness, the higher self. In the situation of the man stealing the bread to feed his children, who is driving the car then? Was it the ego going, well, I'm really going to throw that shot. I've got money in my pocket right here, but screw you, I'm not paying your high prices. And he's stealing it anyway. Or is he going, my children, they're good. If I don't care for them, they're going to be sick. Something bad's going to happen. I just don't have the money. I don't know what to do. And he's doing it that way. Okay, so that's what we have to look at, is what was the impulse for the action? Where did it come from inside us? Did it come from the consciousness, the higher self, which means we're following the will of our Father, we're contributing to the greater good? Or did it come from the negative side of ourselves? Lust, anger, envy, jealousy, fear, all that side of things. Yes?
I have two questions. So now, for that prayer thing, I say it's like, there's two choices, right? You say, I need to help my kids, and whatever else. And like, you steal the for your kids, right? Say, you feed your kids, but then you say, oh, I did that. So some more. Is that's going back again? I don't... Okay, on to the next one. When there's always that choice, ego or essence?
Yes.
When there is no choice, is that the only time you're at the top? Are you not at the top, like where you want to be? Like, the balance.
Well, when you get
the balance,
when you get as high as you need to go, there's only, when you get really high dimensionally, there's only one law that exists, and there's only one choice. That's the will of the Father, and that's it. There really is no other option. Because think of it as God having his will, and that's it. Once you get to that point, once you ascend that high, then everything just merges into one anyway. It's just one consciousness and one choice. Yeah. Just being human, we have this free will. Do this or do this. You've got the angel and the devil on your shoulder, right? The devil always represented the ego. The angel represented the consciousness. In any given situation, think of the old cartoons where something happened and the angel and the devil would pop up and whisper in the ear. That's an analogy for this. The angel is the consciousness, the essence, saying this is what you need to do right now. And the devil is the conscious, saying, no, you want to do this. You want to do this.
That's funny. Disney movies call like the kid. Bruce Willis. I saw it on TV the other day randomly, and like this, like Bruce Willis, like 40 years old or something, and like his like kid, like himself as a kid, like physically comes back to see him. Like he's like 13 when he's a kid, and like comes back to see him, and he's like, oh, my kid, this kid's in my house, but it turns out to be him. It's really weird. I got into it though.
Did you bring this guy?
Yeah, I did.
Oh, okay, so the inferior law right here, these are the laws of man, right? These are the laws of who we are. These are our morals and our customs and all these guidelines that we invent to suit the times. The superior law is the laws of the higher dimensions, okay? So the classic example there is the stealing bread to feed your family one. Now, looking at negotiating karma, most people are surprised to learn that karma is negotiable, okay? As we were talking about earlier, we can understand how to basically take the negative stuff that we've done and compensate for that. Okay, we can literally tip the scales in our favor. We can account for the negative actions that we've done by changing the course of our life into a different direction, to doing more positive things. Positive actions that stem from the consciousness, that don't stem from fear, anger, jealousy, envy, ill will, or whatever that kind of stuff is. Okay, the judges of the law, consequently, you can think of them as basically granting credit to those who request it. You can actually start to change these things for your own benefit. The credit must be paid with good deeds or supreme pain. Okay, so you can either pay with the positive stuff, the good things that you do, or you pay with a negative. It's all like a credit system. This is just a little bit of a hint of things to come. You can actually negotiate directly with the intelligences of karma. The ancient Egyptians gave it the face of Anubis, but it's the same process. There's petitions, there's prayers that you can do, and there's practices and various rituals later on that you can work directly with your own karma.
Okay, we don't get into that stuff now, because if we got into that stuff now, you would just get yourself into trouble, because you would immediately try to get out everything that you've done. And this is one of those things that it's interesting to think about. You can actually alter the course of your life by saying, this is something that I want to do, and this is what I'm going to be paying for that. You can actually manipulate your own karma from a quite a high level, as far as the different dimensions go. You can go up to where karma is accrued, and you can start messing with things there. And that's a really strange thing to think about, and this is something that I was able to actually verify for myself by doing something really stupid. We get into these things later on, because later on, hopefully, you'll have enough experience and enough a bit more consciousness developed, perhaps a bit more control of the ego to not do really silly things. I ended up getting myself into some trouble because I started messing with my own karma and was able to get certain circumstances to go my way, but then didn't want to pay for them. And then I found myself being on the receiving end of that. And the night before a particular event happened, I was visited in the higher dimension. You call it a dream, right? I had a particular dream that showed what was going to happen if I didn't do what I was supposed to do, and I didn't do what I was supposed to do. And when I was sitting on the side of the road after the huge car accident, I went, oh, right, I was showing this already. So that's just a little bit of a taste of things that you can do when you start learning to negotiate in the higher dimensions, start learning things, deep states of meditation, astral projection, and that kind of stuff. Because you can negotiate with karma. There's things that we can ask in order to make our life more positive by being prepared to offer something in exchange. So I need this to happen, and this is what I'm going to do that. This is the good that I'm going to do to offset this negative. But the problem is, many times, because we're human, we have the ego, well, we don't really want to get around to that side, right? Just like with your credit card, you want to buy the stuff, but you don't want to pay it back. The same thing can happen with karma. If you're not careful, you can do some really silly things. Because remember, everything we talk about is, you don't necessarily, we don't believe, it's not belief here, right? You don't believe any of this stuff. You go out and you work with it yourself. You try the techniques, you try the practices, and you see what happens. Everything here is supposed to be tested. We just give you little bits and pieces here and there that you can test. The idea being, as time goes on, you'll get to test bigger and bigger things and more important things. But you're only going to be a little bit careful what you do. So that's why I've given you this teaser here, but I haven't told you how to do it. There's a reason for that. You'll find that out later on, especially when you start working with Second Chamber, when you, you know, spend enough time in this organization. We do big group practices to work with karma and to work with Master Anubis and that kind of stuff. So, yes. Is this about a movie?
No.
Okay.
No, it's what you said. You've seen something that was going to happen before, and then it happened. Now, is that because you didn't learn from that one when you've seen it first?
No, I went in the higher dimensions to negotiate something for myself. And I said, I need this to happen like this, and this is what I'm going to do in order to do that. And then I received the result I wanted, but then decided that because I already had that,
yeah,
smacks of effort to really, you know, do this side of it.
Yeah.
So I didn't, and then I was given a warning, which I ignored, and then I had this something unfold in a dream that said that something really negative was going to happen,
yeah,
if I didn't alter the course of this action, and then I ignored that, and then 2 days later, and it was like a split second before it happened, the vision of, now you have to pay.
Yeah.
Like, what the, where the hell did that come from? And then boom.
Is this car crash, you said?
Oh, yeah.
That's happened with me a little bit, but I got hit by a car.
I was just lying there twice on my bike.
Really?
Yeah.
I only got once.
Okay, the next big thing we have to look at is karma and the ego, because these things are intimately related. Just thought, just sentiment, just action are made impossible because we carry the ego. Which means doing good things for the right reasons is very difficult to do being a human. Because really there's so many different things that are coming into play. Just thought, just sentiment, and just action are hard for us to do because we carry the ego. Remember, we're 97% ego, 3% liberated consciousness. That means 97% of our actions are governed by ill will. They stem from the negative side of ourselves. Only 3% of the time are we doing good for the sake of doing good. Are we doing good because we're following the will of our higher father, because we're following the plan of the universe. Most of the time, we're doing whatever the hell we want. Ego is the cause of our actions. This is really important. Therefore, ego is the cause of the karma. You know what the karma is attracted to? Not the consciousness, the ego. So, what happens if I eliminate the ego? What happened to the karma? It's not necessarily that it disappears, it's gone to the ego. But I'm not with that anymore. I've eliminated that aspect of my psychology. That's why eliminating the ego is so important. That's why when Jesus died on the cross and was reborn, he was illustrating us that whole physical death and then the birth of the spiritual side. We know the physical death was the death of the ego. The birth of the spiritual side was the birth of the consciousness. That was the message Jesus was saying. It's so important. We all have to die within ourselves. Okay, we all have to go through that second birth. The awakening of the consciousness is another term for it. Enlightenment is another term for it. This is something that we have to do. Okay, and karma is another reason why. Because it's the ego that's doing all this behavior. It's the ego that's manifesting this into the universe. So it's the ego that's on the receiving end of this. But if we, at the same time, happen to be wrapped up with those egos, then we get to be on the receiving end of that as well, which is supposed to teach us that this negative thing was the ego. Next time, identify with the consciousness, get rid of this part, and you won't be in this problem. But we never get that lesson. We just keep doing the same thing over and over again, existence to existence, playing into the same egos, identifying with them, doing their will, and then receiving their karma over and over and over again. I see a question for me.
Yeah, it keeps coming to me in different forms.
Okay.
Is this why maybe some souls will, when they come back, reoccur, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's what we're doing,
mm-hmm.
reincarnating.
Mm-hmm.
They choose to maybe take oaths and follow certain paths to sort of help them deal with a lot of karma in one lifetime. Like, for example, nuns and priests and Buddhist monks, people who really give up a lot, and they take vows of poverty and chastity.
Possibly, yeah.
Like conscious vows of poverty to help them kind of get rid of a lot of...
Yeah,
or
and
even those who don't even in a religious sense, but maybe poor people born into poverty or born with deformities and stuff, maybe they've chosen to...
No, it's no choice. Karma is... Yeah, that's what you... So someone who's born with problems with the physical body, that's... Their essence didn't go, I think in this life, no, that's karma. But when you're specifically talking about, like, you know, somebody who's being a nun or a monk or something like that, there are different paths that lead... We'll look at that later on. We have a class called The Four Paths, which talks about those paths. And they are, in what you described, they're almost preparatory paths. They're a way to prepare on the path, and each one of those has a specific thing they're supposed to learn, specific karma or debts that are cancelled that elevate them to a different level. So you're kind of right that way. But the idea of, well, your consciousness wouldn't choose to be born, it's karma that's placing it. Okay, to have a choice, now you're talking reincarnation, now you're talking an awakened master. Jesus was somebody that reincarnated. He was in the higher dimensions, he chose a physical body at a specific place in a specific time to deliver a specific message. That's a choice. We don't have a choice. We're bound on the wheel of samsara, and we come back in this physical body. The circumstances in which we come back are determined by karma. We have to examine our own conduct, analyze our behavior, and become aware of our intentions. That whole concept of self-observation, starting to learn what it is that we're doing. Everything that we do, the actions, the impulses, where do they come from? Now, you're hopefully starting to do that a little bit. Maybe you remember once every few days or whatever, to try to self-observe for a few minutes. Okay? And if you can, plant reminders around your house, stick notes on the wall, have an alarm that goes off, or whatever, at some point, to start to train you to pay attention to your consciousness. To identify, remember the three brains, right? What am I thinking? What am I feeling? What am I doing? Okay? Being aware of the manifestation of the ego versus the consciousness in all three of those aspects of your personality. You know, when that annoying person at work comes by and you're like, oh man, here they come. Wait, what was that? What am I thinking? What am I feeling? What am I doing? Why am I reacting this way? Question what it is you're doing. Because a few minutes of questioning can drastically change the course of your life. Because you've suddenly shifted the attention to the consciousness. It's like a workout for the consciousness. Every time you do that, it gets stronger and stronger and stronger, meaning that you're more likely to be able to discern it from the ego. That's why the very first technique that we really learned here was self-observation. As well as the basic meditation techniques we're developing every week. But self-observation is going to keep coming up again and again and again, and we're going to get deeper and deeper with it in our practices.
going back to that concept I mentioned earlier, how many people are charitable for reasons of guilt? Reasons of wanting to look good in front of ourselves. There's so many corporations and companies that are charitable and environmentally friendly, and they're doing this on one side to look good and to sell more stuff, but in the mean side, they're destroying communities and doing all kinds of horrible things, right? We have to examine where the impulse for the behavior comes from. We have to learn to do good consciously. And that's the key. Doing good consciously, okay? Stemming from the consciousness, okay? Not, you know, from the state that we find ourselves in, from this unconscious state that we find ourselves in, where everything, 97% of our actions, are motivated or impulsed by the ego. It's the ego that we're dancing to. It's the puppet master. We want to change that. We want to do good consciously for the right reasons. Once we start doing that, then we're going to see the circumstances of our life begin to drastically change for the positive. Okay, being aware of the implications of our own actions. When we're identifying with the ego, we don't care about the outcome of our own actions. We've all done this. Who's been angry before and ended up saying, oh, I'm sorry, I don't know what I was thinking, I don't know what came over me, I didn't mean to. Of course, everybody has. Because the ego doesn't care about the consequences. And that's the problem. You always go with the impulses of the egos and don't really want to deal with the consequences. Or we're aware of them, we just want to get out of them somehow. Or have them not apply to us in some way. If we eliminate ego, we eliminate the karma associated with the ego. So let's go back to me doing that negative thing a year ago. Let's say whatever, oh, I took the guy's wife, right? That was the thing, the example we were using. And we said, okay, what caused that? We said, well, that action was caused by the ego. There's two ways to remedy that. I could try to tip the scales in my favor by doing a lot more conscious good to try to cancel that debt when it comes. Or I could go, what caused that action? That was lust that made me do that. Okay, I'm going to work with eliminating lust within me. So I'm going to try to self-observe every time lust's involved, okay? Remember, there's a three-step process that we briefly touched at about eliminating the ego. The first step is observation. The second step is comprehension. The third step is elimination. We're all the way down here. You guys are still messing around with the observation stage, okay? Eventually, we'll talk about taking the observation stage into comprehension and how we fully comprehend an ego. Because once you fully comprehend an ego, then you can eliminate it from your personality. Okay? And once you've eliminated the ego, you've eliminated karma. So another way I could get out of that situation that I've got this negative karma coming at me for taking somebody else's wife is eliminate the ego of lust. If I no longer carry that, then I'm no longer able to do that same action. Okay? The karma would no longer serve a purpose as we wouldn't commit the same error again. That's what repentance meant in the Bible. What was repentance? The idea of being truly sorry. What's the difference between being sorry for something and being truly repentant for something? Being truly repentant says that you can, it's not physically possible for you to do the same error again. You know, people that have, probably your own friends, people that do bad stuff all the time and say, yeah, I'm sorry. Then you start to go, you know what? Your apology means nothing. You keep doing this over and over again. What does sorry mean, right? True repentance from the biblical concept context meant eliminating the possibility of you ever being able to do the action again. We read a bit further into that, that means eliminating the ego. That's what repentance is. When repentance is genuine and complete, karma radically changes. There's no punishment required if the lesson is learned. Right? If we've taken that step to perfect ourselves, there's no need for the corrective behavior. Because we got it. We got it this time. We got the lesson. It's okay. No, I don't need that. I got it. I know what you're talking about. I know what I have to do. Okay? That's repentance. That's the concept of the biblical repentance. And remember the quote from the Bible, for the unworthy, all doors are closed except one, that of repentance. Okay, the doors being the doors to the higher dimensions, they're all closed. The unworthy is us, those who have sins, and an ego are the same thing. For the unworthy, all doors are closed except one, that of repentance. It's only by repenting our sins do we get into heaven. The definition of repentance meaning elimination. Yes?
Is that any physical death for some people? Do they have to physically die to come back around again?
Not sure what you mean.
Like, you said there's one door for people who are...
All doors are closed except one.
Yeah.
Doors to the higher dimensions.
That's just like...
That means there's only one way to get into heaven. Okay. For the unworthy, for us, there's only one way you're going to get into heaven. All doors are closed except one. And the only way you're going to get in is through repentance. Repentance not meaning, yeah, I'm real sorry, I accept Jesus. Oh, that was easy. It means... eliminating from your psychology that which caused the action.
If you repent through that door, can we say eliminate one ego? Is that a start? Like, is that
it's a start.
Is another door open after that? Like, say one door and two. cuter than four. Four than one.
Mm. No, you eliminate the ego and that gets you. That's what we're trying to do.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, while you carry the ego, you're bound to the physical plane. You're going to come back here. Yes.
So is original sin just a picture for the ego on humanity?
The original concept of the original sin explains the origin of the ego and the development of humanity. We'll get into that later on. Because Adam and Eve represented an earlier race of humanity. The Garden of Eden is the higher dimensions. The fall of the Garden of Eden and the fall of man is
and
how we
Eve is
where
just
we
representative
are.
Of the mother of humanity.
No, females and males, like all females, all males.
Oh yeah, okay.
Yeah, and then we'll talk about that later on. That's a fascinating. The Book of Genesis is fascinating. We'll get into that later on, and we'll look at what all those different symbols mean. But the getting kicked out of the Garden of Eden is getting kicked out of heaven, and we're stuck down here, barred, and we can't get back in because we've lost the path. And we'll get into that. The last thing we'll look at is there's different types of karma. The first type of karma is individual karma. That's karma we receive for our actions. So we do something, we get to receive it. Okay, we reap what we sow on a personal level. The next type of karma is family karma. Now this is interesting. The law of karma binds us to our family members. We're born to the family we have because of karma. Families suffer karma together. We all know families that are like, the whole family's cursed, right? Everybody, going back generations. That's family karma. Those people being born again and again and again, and they're always struggling. They're always going through challenges. And the opposite, we know families that, like, everybody's blessed. Everybody has, you know, all these great things happen to them in life, and everything they touch just seems to turn to gold. That's an example of a family receiving dharma together, because we're bound to our family members. Going on a different higher level, oh, yes?
I have a question on that.
Sure.
So once we become somewhat aware and conscious and we're living from a higher self, how can we help that family and other members start lifting up themselves to help them overcome, get out of that themselves? Or is it not our responsibility and our responsibilities to ourselves to come out of it and just be that change?
Yeah.
And let it reflect.
Yeah,
that
rather
way.
Than meddling in other people, because you
right.
got to be careful.
Because that's
that
karmic also.
Yeah, because
right.
sometimes you can think, you can do what you think is right for
exactly.
somebody, but that's you imposing your will on somebody else,
right.
and you got to be really careful when you start doing that.
So really, it's that work we do.
Yeah. Remember the Greeks, Gnosite Ipsum. Know thyself.
Yeah.
Not only you people, know yourself.
Yeah.
Okay, and reflecting within Gandhi, be the change you want to see, and all that kind of stuff. But we don't want to do that. I want to make you people better because I'm already
yeah.
perfect. That's
yeah.
our tendency. And by making you better, I'm holding you to my standards. Standards that were now set by the ego, not
yeah.
the consciousness. There's no way we can start to help other people before we start helping ourselves. The next level of karma is collective karma. That's many people that are seemingly unrelated put in similar situations. So a car crash where a bunch of people die, or imagine a plane crash. We've all heard the story, somebody was going to get on the plane, but at the last minute somebody made them not, and they didn't go on the plane, and then there was this huge plane crash, right? Because they didn't have that karma to pay, the other people did. So situations of seemingly unrelated people that suffer the same negative circumstances, that's collective karma. So we've got individual, families, and just a group of uncollected people. Going at an even higher level karmically, we've got national karma. That's karma experienced by entire regions. The Middle East has been paying some serious national karma for like a couple thousand years, okay? Or countries where there's civil wars, okay? There's just parts of it, let's face it, there's parts of this world where the condition and quality of your life will be drastically different depending where you're born into or where you have the ability to go later in life. Canada's a great place to be. There are certain parts of the Middle East and Africa that probably aren't so great to be just because of the conditions that are there. That's an example of national karma. There's world karma. Sometimes as humanity, we large groups of us suffer together. The world wars were a good example of world karma. And things like that will continue to happen as we do the same stupid things over and over again. Okay? Epidemics that sweep across the globe are other examples of world karma. Going even higher, this is a type of karma called hard karma. This is the one no one likes to think about. Hard karma is sometimes you can do something that was so negative, you owe that debt now. There's no getting out of it, there's no tipping the scales, there's nothing that you can do that will change that debt. That's hard karma. For example, somebody that was born without legs. Doesn't matter what good they do, doesn't matter how much ego they eliminate, they're not just going to spontaneously grow legs. That's an example of hard karma. It's just when they come into that life, that debt is owed right now and it is paid. There's not a way for them to manage or negotiate that one. Okay, and nobody likes to really think about that. It's a difficult one to think about, but that's what hard karma is. Yes?
Do you personally think that this world, that our world karma is that is hard in ways of saying that we are actually doomed to watch the world fall apart as it currently seems? Or do you think that it's something that actually turns around based on individual change?
Well, there's an even bigger cycle that's in play at that one. But you already know about it. Right? There's even bigger cycles that play into some of that kind of stuff. So no, there's no getting out of that. The fact that we're here at a particular time for that, that's karma. To being able to be witness to certain events or at certain times or being born into certain time periods, then yes, that's karmic. But the idea being that if remember that this is the physical world. In the higher dimensions, you know what they call the physical world? They call this place the Valley of Tears. Because even coming here means that, you know, we're in the wrong place. We need to get out of here and go somewhere else. Mm-hmm. So even being here in the first place is karmic to a certain extent. That's hard karma. The hard karma is the stuff that you can imagine, you know, somebody being born blind or something like that. That's whatever they've done. There was a debt that needed to be collected, or a debt from numerous existences, which was collected at a particular point in time, and they owed that the second that they came into this existence. Yes?
I'm just going to touch on that. What if someone is like so severely disabled that even their brain has, is completely underdeveloped, and they don't even have the capacity to tap into a higher consciousness to, improve themselves or perfect themselves? Or
then
whatever.
It's the karma of that consciousness to ride out that life. Unfortunately, it's kind of not a pleasant thing to think about, but yeah, if they don't have the ability to develop and awaken consciousness, then that's basically a life that they've lost being able to work towards that because of actions of the previous. And that may have been, they have maybe wasted so many opportunities they had that it's just added up that way. Yeah.
So going along that line, how could that be corrected? If it was one lifetime of being severely disabled?
Next time around?
Well, I think it's corrected in the fact that it's such a hard life and you're having to go through it that you are automatically shedding that stuff.
It's a debt that's paid. It's like, I'm paying that now, okay, you're done, that's it. No money left over, you have to wait till you get your next paycheck. I'm taking that whole paycheck right now, wait till the next one around. Think of it that way. The next paycheck being an analogy for the next life.
Yeah.
So if you look at it that way. That's exactly how hard karma works. Yes?
Do you pay karma in this life too? Like something you did 10 years ago? Like let's say you robbed somebody, would you be robbed?
Yeah, possibly. Remember, we get funky when we want to put things on a timeline, right? Mm-hmm. Karma is karma. It's just going to happen at some point. It could be this life. It could be the next life. It's not, you can't say, well, I did something bad here, so how many months, days, weeks elapse before it comes back to me? It doesn't quite work like that because we tend to see time linearly, but from the concept of karma, everything's happening basically simultaneously, so it all happens all at once anyway, which is weird. After hard karma, we have something called katansia, karma of the gods and masters. Remember I mentioned earlier, karma was at a really high dimensional level, and everything below it is subject to karma. So even angels, angels fall, they pay karma, right? Angels being just a name for the divinities, the intelligences, the entities that reside in the higher dimensions, the other levels of consciousness that exist in the higher dimensions. So karma is something that's at a much high level that even the angelic beings, even the awakened masters, have to be aware of, have to be conscious of, and judge their actions accordingly. The only way you escape karma is when you get to the level of the will of the Father, because there is only one will, and you cannot stray from it. That's the only way you can be, free from the will of karma. The next one, this is the one that no one wants to think about, karmasaya. Every time you have sexual relations with somebody, you are karmically binding yourself to them for the next time around. That's what everybody's brows immediately thrills, and you start doing the math tally, right? Like, wait a minute. That's because we do. As we go from lifetime to lifetime, egos seek other people out. So we find ourselves karmically bound to not only people like our family, not only friends, but also people that we're in relationships with. Okay, and we repeat the same things over and over again because those same egos exist and will exist to satisfy their various desires through the various relationships that we have. Okay, so every time that you're sexually uniting with someone, you're creating a karmic bond which will bring you to that person at another existence, at another point in time. Yes?
But we can rise above that by working with...
Yes, absolutely.
And eliminating the egos.
Absolutely.
That created that action.
And this can be a very positive. It can be a positive thing, or it can be a negative thing. It can be negative in the fact that if you've had problematic relationships, they're going to continue to follow you around. It can be positive in that everybody has a partner that they can use to spiritually elevate themselves.
Because, like, say there's some people in relationships that, I'm going to use a woman, she gets married to a guy and he has a lot of affairs on her and she stays quiet and she stays married to him forever, even knowing about that. Is she's karmically bonded to him because of what she's done before, but if she starts recognizing that and working with the ego that brought that on in the first place and eliminates it, she won't necessarily be karmically bonded with him again.
No, exactly. Remember, when we limit the ego, we limit the karma.
Right.
So that's the importance of really eliminating the ego, because that's how you change this kind of stuff. But yeah, while she carries the ego within her that was part of that situation, then that situation is going to seek to repeat itself, because the egos reoccur to satisfy the wants and desires. So that's the thing. Everybody that ends up, you know, in our life at some point, we see again and again. And this is really confirmed when you start messing around with your past lives. And you really start to see that you have some of the same characters over and over again. A lot of your relationships are with the same people. You may have experienced this already. Everyone's kind of had that dream before where they see their significant other in the dream, but it doesn't quite look like them. But the whole dream, you act like it's them. You just know it's them. That's probably them and how they looked in a past life. So you get caught up with the same people over and over again. So that's something to remember. That's no one likes to think about karma sai. Especially when you look back and you've got a great relationship now, you're like, oh, karma sai, we're going to be together in the next life. Oh, that's nice. And then you got to remember all the other ones you had before. It's like, oh, not those again. Seriously? Okay. And that's, it's just a karmic bonding. And this is just what we do from existence to existence to existence. And that will have more ramifications later on when... Later on, we'll look at how we can use a partner to elevate ourselves. Because really, the true spiritual development is done as a couple, right? The original story of Adam and Eve and all that kind of stuff. And we'll see how that plays in later on. But that's karma saya for you. By this union, the two people share karma. By karma saya, the couple remain united in the book of karma, which means it's just you're going to keep recurring over and over and over again. You're going to always have that bond there, that karmic bond, unless you eliminate the ego that set that bond up in the first place. The closing statement, as I mentioned earlier, all doors except one are closed to the unworthy, that of repentance. Ask and it shall be given, knock and it shall be opened. All we have to do is something. Not nothing, something. That's the key. Ask and it shall be opened, knock. Ask and knock are action words. It suggests something that's not just passive. Okay? To really change the course of our life, we have to do something. Not the same nothing over and over again. But to do something. Change comes from action. Okay? And action comes from understanding all the stuff and putting it into practice.